Another part of assessing the data that we use in GIS, how we function with data, what we do with it, so on and so on, is digging a little bit into where our data come from, how they emerge, how they function, what means of collection generated them, so on and so on. This gets us into questions about data reliability, data function, data creation. There's a lot of data you can take on your own. You can make data. You can create data sets through many different means. And a lot of people create data sets through lots of different processes. So we can think about some common data types, how they function, how they operate. If we can map it, we can use it in a GIS. If we can assign it spatial coordinates, if we can connect those attributes and those spatial coordinates with that linkage, we can do it in GIS. If we have things that aren't explicitly spatial, we can map those sometimes. And really, most of it depends on formatting. If you have a list of addresses, that might not seem immediately inputable into GIS, but there's ways to do that, geocoding that. You want to just make a map of the trees around you, and you know what the tree is, you know where the tree is located, you can build that too. So there's lots of ways we can create data and data sets. But there's also things that are more complicated than one person can create. And we have to rely on other systems and structures to make that data. You or I can't go out and do a census of the whole country, of our whole state, or of whatever government unit we're thinking of. We might work and contribute to a census. We might respond to one, but we alone can't make that. So we have to rely sometimes on the work of other people, or the work of governments, or of corporations, or of universities, or whoever might be creating such data. In those cases, we might want to ask questions about who made this data? Why did they make this data? What kind of biases or structures are present in this data that we might want to consider? Is that a broad enough word? Maybe critique is a better word. So let's think about some of these, a small selection of data types. There's plenty more data than this. One common piece of data everyone likes to use is a land cover map. I found this in my years of teaching to be a very popular, very in-demand data type. I want to know the land cover of my area. Where can I get a land cover map? Well, often these emerge from satellite images or aerial photos. So we have all of these satellite platforms out and about. Take a remote sensing class sometime if you want to learn more about how those satellites work. But we have all these satellites. They are collecting imagery information, sometimes as false colors, sometimes as visual bands, sometimes as infrared bands, all this kind of energy, all this kind of data that is sensing energy. And we get little snapshots like this. It's from Landsat 7. Lovely little, what would I call this? Probably call this. You can see an urban area, lower right, some lakes, and then it gets a little bit greener and more rural. Maybe that's a ski area, center left there, certainly not in this picture where it's green and summery. So maybe it's like hiking trails. Who knows what it could be? We can turn this into a land cover map by using classification methods, by using processing techniques, by using all kinds of different things. To say, okay, that's water. Those blue areas are water. We know that because of the infrared energy that they're reflecting, or the spectral energy that they're reflecting. That's water. That's shrubland. That's forest. That's urban. So on and so on and so on. So land cover maps can come from satellite data or aerial photos. Before we had satellite data giving us this type, this level of information, we would do this from aerial photos. And experts who knew, oh, that texture of tree is a spruce, going to write a spruce. And that texture of tree is an oak, going to write oak. And that's a lake. Create these by hand. And then we'd have land cover data sets created by people from air photos. So we've had land cover maps going back many years. They're not just a satellite era thing. This data is often available in both raster and vector format. Raster data lends itself well to land cover, especially when it comes from satellite data. Satellite data is raster data, so connects there. It gets a little stair-steppy, you can see on the right-hand photo, or the right-hand example, especially when it is of high pixel resolution. Big pixels, big steps, big squares. We also see vector data, much more precise. Strangely enough, often a lot larger because of the precision. Because you start to get these, you know, say 1 meter resolution drawings of the exact lake boundary or the exact wetland boundary or whatever. Plus then all the attributes inside. But both are fairly common ways of seeing land cover. Another piece of data in my experience that people always want to talk about are census maps. Look in the mail, get your census every 10 years. I think in the US we had some kind of online response. I don't know exactly how it worked. I did my census in 2020 in the US in the mail, but often this is mailed or someone comes to your door and says, hey, time to census. There was the census 2010 form. Ask some questions, have some classifications. Who lives here? What's their, well, we have race and age and sex, sometimes asking about income or education, depending on which, if it's the official formal decadal census, it's the basics. If they are the interim community surveys, the American Community Survey, for example, it's more information than that about could be income, education, how you commute to work. Every country operates and conducts its census differently and collects different data and has different problems. Here's population density from the 2000 census. The census process in 2020 in the United States was very fraught politically. There were a lot of attempts to change the questions at the last minute. You might think, oh, well, you think about your American election schedules. We know a new president was elected in 2016. So it's like, oh, well, certainly 4 years is enough time to change the census. Absolutely not. It is it's very much a decadal process to develop the census and make sure the questions are accurate and make sure we want to represent things in accurate ways and so on and so on and so on. The last Canadian census ran into troubles as well with data quality and how it was asked and how it was distributed. Maybe not the last one, a recent Canadian census. The timeline is lost a little bit on me. Census data allows us to start consolidating things like population into different groups or into different pods or into different amalgamations, but the census is not neutral. The census just doesn't emerge from the void. It is a political document. Every census that has ever been done has had different ways of representing race, has had different ways of counting who counts as a person. This is deeply seated in the prejudices of the then and now. And just because we're operating in a GIS, which is, you know, a happy program on our computer, and we're looking at all these maps, does not mean that that data that we are using allows us to ignore structural issues with that data. We are just as responsible, maybe even more responsible, for understanding bias and for understanding data collection issues and for understanding problems with that data before we make maps or make decisions or make solutions with that data. Very much a GIS ethics in there as well. Here's one of those uses for GIS data: redistricting, which we know is not a political process at all and has always only been done fairly and without any thought of political advantage. Can you feel me staring at the microphone? Population data is used to redistrict every 10 years. Depending on who's in power, depends on who draws the lines, and depending on who draws the lines, depends on who gets the seats in Congress. Especially interesting is the 2011 redistricting in Pennsylvania on the left. Same data, you could draw the opposite results. 13-5. Either party, just by drawing the lines a little differently. You can see North Carolina on the right. Democrats redistricted one way, Republicans redistricted another. This whole process is called gerrymandering. There's some more gerrymanders. Every party does it. This is not limited to one political party in the United States. It is very much an American thing, though. The writings in Canada or the UK, parliamentary democracies across the world generally don't have this kind of problem. But the US does. Some of these districts are separated by measurements in yards, I guess connected by is the better way to say that. But however they're unified, they're made by people. And they're made by people with agendas. And you might then map one of these congressional districts. Or you might map a representation area. Then it becomes your responsibility as someone using data to say, is this an accurate way of understanding the question I'm asking? Are these units, are these areas the proper way to understand this pattern I'm looking at? See in this example how you can draw the same population of 60% team blue, 40% team red into three very different representations of the people there. We can also use roads in our GIS data, far less controversial. I always love when I talk about data to go from something deeply controversial and politically charged to roads. There are road files for the whole US. There are road files for pretty much any country in the world. Go to OpenStreetMap, get all of the road data for everywhere if you want it. Roads are good. They tell you what road you're on. Another one of those pieces of data that people like to see: distance from road, understanding where people are in relation to different roads. Street view, that's a road. Google collects this data. More available in some countries than others. Some of that is road access. Some of that is privacy. In the European Union, privacy laws are very restrictive of how long Google Maps data can stay up. In the US, it's just going to be up there forever. This road information then allows us to understand linkages between where we are, how we are in relation to this big infrastructure, how we are in relation to addresses, Right? We can turn any address into a point in our map just through something called geocoding. Geocoding turns an address into a point on the map. And this is often stored with census information, at least in the US. Hence when it is, why it's included there. Another big piece of data, very popular piece of data people want to use are topographic maps. You could get this the old fashioned way, go out into the woods, survey, collect a bunch of elevation points, and then create a topographic map. Like the topo quads. Look how fun that must be. Our big world data set for topography comes from the Shuttle Radar Topography Mission, SRTM. Yes, that's the space shuttle, and it had a radar on it, and it radared the planet. Well, most of the planet. The SRTM data is the essentially the global elevation data set. It collects data, elevation data at roughly a 60 meter scale, good enough for regional understanding of elevation differences. There's some processing and downsampling in that that might make it more useful in some areas than others. There's also, in some places around the world, LIDAR data, light detecting and ranging. That's where you shoot a laser at the ground and you get very high resolution data. Like that lovely map on the left. You can see a lot more of the landscape with lasers. Other things that could be created from this include things like change maps, like old aerial photos. Look at the change between them, or I mean, really go back to those land cover maps. Take a land cover map from 2005, a land cover map from 2015. Look at the differences. Measure the differences. What has changed from agricultural land to development? What's changed from beach to water? And sometimes that can go deeper in history as you go to the pre-satellite era information. We can also collect data just from GPS information, from point values. So we think about, for example, here's some migration routes. In a pre-South Sudan study in Sudan and Ethiopia here, or some gazelle migration, point maps allow us to understand the distribution of things. Point maps allow us to understand where things are. This is not the limit of all the data that's out there. I could probably talk for hours about data sources. There's more data out there than this. But there's more data out there than this. That's exciting. If you can't find exactly what you need, you might be able to create it yourself. Often that's a data management piece that is worth mentioning. If you need a map, say, of just your town or your village or your region or your conduits, whatever you live in, try not just a GIS layer out there that says, here is your town, personally just for you. You probably have to carve it out of another data set. That's fine. Create it and manage your data. We never want to assume that any of our data are perfect. Make sure you are critical about your data. Who made it? Why did they make it? How did they make it? What biases went into making it? What can be done with it that is reasonable and logical? All of this data work and manipulation is part of GIS. Always part of GIS.